to arise, shine, for the Lord has come. I minister Michael Kernan, bringing to you a full gospel Christ teaching ministry, which is committed to the uncompromised word of God, allowing God's people to come out of darkness and into his marvelous light. But first, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, open the ears of the people that are listening to this broadcast so they might understand with their heart and be converted. And I pray against all hindering spirits that might try to prohibit this glorious gospel from being effectual. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen. Thank you, Jesus. The name of the message today is Watch as Well as Pray. Watch as well as pray. Before we got saved, we all had different upbringings, which produced prejudices and certain world views that were ingrained into our carnal way of thinking. Some of them we formed on our own. Some of them our parents put in there. You know, some of them this world put in there. And like I said, certain world views. What do I mean by that? That's like being entitled or disenfranchised. Two polar opposites there. Being entitled or being disenfranchised. So we got all these different, God has to deal with all kinds of different issues with each person. Hallelujah. And each person didn't have the same background. Let's put it this way. There's an accident on a corner. There's an intersection. And two cars hit each other. One turned this way and the other, you know. And there's a person on each corner. On each corner, there's a person standing. They're all going to have a different point of view. Some will hear a motor rev. Some will hear this. Some will see that. You know, and it has to do sometimes with their background, who might, what kind of make a car it could be. I mean, all these different things play in to when a police goes there and has to write out a report, and he's got to get eyewitness reports, you know. So each person, they could be at the exact same event, but all four might have a completely different point of view. And the police, you know, they always say, I don't want to hear what you think. Just tell me what you saw. So that's what God's doing. Hallelujah. He's helping us with all our different backgrounds, with all our different things that we bring. Hallelujah. Our unlovely things, our sinful nature that we bring to God. And he's got to take it out. Thank you, Jesus. Unfortunately, a lot of this baggage we take with us to the cross. And it doesn't all go away automatically. Some of us hang on to the baggage. And we got to learn how to turn these things loose. These fleshly bodies that have sinful flesh, hallelujah, and our family identities, you know, who we were when we grew up, and all these different things that we come to the cross, and we got to lay them at the feet of Jesus, hallelujah, and sometimes it has to come one thing at a time. God will pull all that gook out of your heart, hallelujah, one thing at a time. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus said, I'm going to turn there. This applies to this, Luke 9 and 23, Luke 9 and 23, and he said to them all, and what the word of God says to one, it says to all. If any man will come after me, call himself a Christian. You're gonna talk the talk. You need to walk the walk, is what he's saying here. Let him deny himself. Step one, you got to turn your back on your old sinful nature. That's step one. And that's only step one. But thank you, Jesus. His grace will allow us to get it done. Take up his cross daily. That means, you know what? This world is going to be lovely to you at times. And you can't show them your old nature. You got to show them the new nature. Thank you, Jesus. And some people sitting right in the church house, they might throw a barb at you, thinking they're being funny. But you know what? You didn't think it was funny. That's why I say different prejudices and different worldviews. I could say something that could really wound someone. And unless they tell me, I might not know. But thanks be to God, I got the Lord to tell me when somebody had been wounded. And then I go apologize to that person. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Take up his cross and take up his cross daily. Taking up his cross. That means, you know what? We got to keep picking it up. Don't put it down. Because, I mean, you can come under attack in your own bedroom and nobody's around you. That devil can start bringing up things to your memory you know, about things that happened in the past, and this person hurt you, and that person hurt you. You got to pick up your cross, and you got to carry it daily. I'm gonna say, second by second, just don't put it down. Go to bed with that cross, knowing, you know what, Lord, you're pulling all that gook out of my heart. You're taking all that filth out of my heart, one thing at a time. And it is uncomfortable at first. It does feel like a cross. It does feel like a cross. It does feel like you're denying yourself. Sometimes he'll tell you things that will put self off to the side. And you're going to help other people instead of doing things that you wanted to do. You know, I want to do this and I want to do that. Let me go there. St. John, I believe it's the last chapter. Jesus was having a conversation with Peter before he was taken up. He was, verse 15 through 17, he asked him three separate occasions, feed my people, feed my sheep, feed my lambs, feed them, Peter. Hallelujah. Do you love me more than these? He's talking about this world. Hallelujah. And then in verse 18, he said, truly, truly, I say unto thee, when thou was young, thou gird thyself and walked where thou would. You did your own thing and not mine. Hallelujah. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee where thou would not. And it says in the 19th verse, this spake he, signifying what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said unto him, follow me. Now follow me. Don't, you know, you're going to get to a point, just like Peter here. You're going to stop doing your own thing. That's denying yourself. Picking up your cross and following me. You know what? This old man's going to have to die. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15 and 31, I die daily. I die daily. I want to turn there. This is important. This doesn't just all happen at once. This is a walk. This walk we walk with God. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 15 and 31. I protest by your rejoicing, which I have in Christ Jesus, our Lord, I die daily. Hallelujah. If after the manner of men, I fought with beasts at Ephesus. He's talking after the manner of men. These aren't beasts. These are men that are behaving as farm animals and worse, wild animals. What advantage me if the dead rise not? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. He's showing them here, you know what? I protest by your rejoicing, which I have in Christ Jesus our Lord, I die daily. This is a daily thing. That's picking up your cross daily. This old man is being crucified, hallelujah, with Christ. Thank you, Jesus. And as we learn to turn him loose, as we learn to trust in Jesus, as we learn to do those things that please him, Jesus said, why call me Lord and do not the things what I say? If I don't do what Jesus tells me to in his word and in his spirit, I got no life in me. You can say all these things, you know, I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. You know what? I'm going to do what he tells me to do. And just like he said to Peter, just back there, a little back in St. John, in the last chapter, you know, you're going to turn away from the things you used to do and start following Jesus. And he's going to be Lord of your life. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He's going to be Lord of your life. And I'm going to turn now to 2 Corinthians 12. I'm going to start at 7. I'm going to go down to 9. 10. I'm going to go down to 10. 1 Corinthians 12 and 7. And least I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given unto me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, least I should be exalted above measure. God had to allow Satan to touch Paul so his flesh, man, wouldn't be exalted. So he could stay in the spirit. It says in the scriptures that God seeks such to worship him, that worship him in spirit and in truth. And when you get too big for yourselves, when you think it's all about you, you better know it isn't. It's about Jesus. It's about a sacrifice. It's about what God did for us. And when we walk in this walk, when we talk this talk, he can start pulling that stuff out of our heart. Thank you, Jesus, that the devil put in there. Thank you, Jesus. For this thing I besought the Lord three times, thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I glory in my infirmities. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecutions and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. So when you turn the old man loose, and you know what? You put him last on your list. That's the way I look at it. When I put myself last and all the other saints first, including sinners, I'm going to reach for that soul. Hallelujah. And God said, that's picking up your cross. That's denying self. That's putting my son, Jesus, first in your life. And you will have life abiding in you when you live what I tell you to do. When you do, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you truly love me, keep my commandments. And my Father, hallelujah, my Father will dwell inside you. Thank you, Jesus. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient. So God's grace is his love, absolutely. St. John 3:16, God so loved the world. And those are sinners. Thank you, Jesus, who I was one, definitely. I was a sinner. I was a chief sinner out there. His grace brought me from that man to where I am today. And I believe that God can bring me the rest of the way home to a nature that he will be glad to dwell with through eternity. Hallelujah. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. So when it's not about me, when I stop trying to do things for God and just be obedient to what he told me to do in the first place through his word, and then a spirit will add to that things, hallelujah, that he finds offensive that I might do. Here's an example. Years ago, and I've said this many occasions, I'm going to try to keep this testimony short. Years ago, I had a disc offered to me, a CD-ROM. It was a computer hardware, a program for CAD. I was offered it for free. You know, just download it and you can have it. And I thought, well, okay, you know, I wasn't really thinking about it. But at the time, I think I was even taking a CAD course through my college. That I was going to through apprenticeship school that I was going through at the time. And I didn't think nothing about it. I told the person, sure, yeah, why not? I'll take it, you know, a free gift. And God told me not to. He said, don't. It was about $900 to buy that thing from a store. And here's why. God doesn't want us to steal those things because those people make a living off producing those items. And that's what God told me. Now, he didn't tell you that. He told me that. And you know what? It stuck with me. When God tells you something, he puts it in your spirit, and it stays there. And you'll never forget it. So if it's a CD, a DVD, a CD-ROM, all those things, if I need one, I will go out and purchase one. Thank you, Jesus. And there's been times since then that somebody has wanted me to look at a CD, and I seen it, and I liked it. So I went out and bought it anyway, even though I had a copy of it. But I purposed to make sure that I did that thing that pleased my Heavenly Father. So you know what? Those people are trying to make a living off that. And I'm not going to, you know, and ultimately, a true Christian is treating others the way you want to be treated. So I'm not going to rob from somebody when I don't want to be robbed from myself. I know when somebody shortchanged me, I get pretty testy. You know, like, oh, you shortchanged me a nickel. Now compare that to a $900 piece of software. You know, there's a little proportional error there, I'm sure. But, you know, if we don't like to be stole from, why should we like to steal from someone else knowingly? And that's just one way that the Spirit spoke to me that he did not in his word. But he showed me conclusively, this is not like me. This is not like me. His children are not pirates. They call that pirating. When you unload, you download one illegally, and you use it for your own personal enjoyment. That's called pirating. And God's people are not pirates. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There's something that you'll find as we continue this walk, that my old man is constantly trying to resurrect. He's constantly trying to become in charge again, to try to lead me away from the Spirit. This man needs to be crucified. Paul said, I die daily. This is a daily walk. Jesus said, pick up your cross daily. This is something we have to do 7/24. Here's an example. I heard recently that in the original Hebrew, the word religion was not in the original Hebrew. Religion is something man's word. Mankind made that word up to talk about a book in a way that they think God is trying to lead them. Where God wants us to just completely sell out to Him. That is the Christian character. That is the Christian life. We just sell out to Jesus. We just sell out to God. We sell out to His Holy Spirit. We sell out to what He wants us to do, who He wants us to be. And thank you, Jesus. He says, I will get this work done in you. Hallelujah. Let's go to Matthew 7. Judge not, and 1, 7 and 1, Matthew 7 and 1, judge not that ye be not judged. For with judgment ye judge, ye shall be judged, and with what measure ye meet, it shall be measured to you again. And why, behold, thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye, a sliver, but consider not the beam that is in thy own eye. Or how wilt thou say unto thy brother, let me pull out the mote out of thy eye, and behold, a beam is in thy own eye? Thou hypocrite, first cast out the beam out of thy own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly. He cast out the mote that is in thy brother's eye. I did a lesson not that long ago called Mercy Rejoices Against Judgment. So when we're merciful to those that are unrighteous, those sinful people that, you know, we used to be. I know I used to be a sinful man. I wasn't too cool when I was in the world. And we're going to be merciful to those. And some of the brethren in the church who still, you wonder if they're saved. And they lash out at you from time to time and say things that are, you know, really odd and hurtful. And you're like looking at them like, where did that come from? Well, that came from flesh. That came from sinful flesh. And it rose up and it overpowered their mouth. So they spoke a word that was really ungracious to you or to somebody in your presence. And you thought, well, that wasn't right. Why would he or she have said that? Because you know what? They were overpowered by that spirit of flesh, of sinful flesh. And it says in the Bible that if we would, hallelujah, St. James 3:2, for in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man. They say there are no perfect men. But God's calling you perfect if you simply put a zipper on it. The same is a perfect man and able also to bridle the whole body. We can control the whole body. This whole man, my entire being, I can control him. Hallelujah. This man is supposed to be under control. I'm supposed to have my holy foot on this dead man's head. Hallelujah. And whenever he wiggles like the snake that he used to be, I'm no longer sinful flesh. I'm a temple of the Holy Ghost. But when he wiggles around, hallelujah, there's times God won't say a word. And there's other times God will say ahead of time to me, don't say nothing. And I know what he's talking about now. He doesn't want me. Somebody's going to come against me, and they're going to say something to try to rear up my old man's ugly head, you know, that old man, that old serpent that I used to be, and try to get me to lash back out. Put a zipper on it and just let it go. And that's what it says. At that point, you're a perfect man because you're controlling. Hallelujah. You're not incontinent anymore. You're not out of control. You're measured with your words. And there's a lot of times that I've got to be measured with my words now. Hallelujah. When I preach the word, I got to be measured with my words. Isn't that right? Let's go to, again, watch as well as pray. Who are we watching? We're watching everyone. We're watching everyone. I'm especially watching myself. Where was that? That was, got to go this way. First Corinthians 11 and 31 and 32. 1 Corinthians 11, 31. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. What does that mean? If we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. If we would police ourselves, if we would put a zipper on that lip when we need to, hallelujah. Sometimes the Lord comes to me ahead of time. Other times, he doesn't. You know, what he's doing is he's trying to get us to walk on our own with his spirit inside us. And as you live this life, as you go through the paces, as you will, as I'm no longer being reared by my worldly parents, I'm being reared by my heavenly Father now. Thank you, Jesus. And he's bringing me up through this, what he calls the new birth. And this new birth is opposite, literally 100% opposite. Instead of seeking to be rich, we're seeking that others may be rich in the glory of his word. And be rich in good works. Be rich in graciousness toward our fellow man. Hallelujah. And instead of climbing that ladder of success, we're helping our brethren do it. And our sisters. We're helping them get up that ladder ahead of us. We don't mind standing last in line. And that's something the world cannot understand. Only a child of God after the infilling of God's Holy Spirit. I say this all the time. The road gets narrower all the time. It used to be broad. Just like he said to Peter, you used to go and do your own thing and do whatever you wanted. But now, you're gonna walk on a smaller path. And that path is going to get narrower and narrower and narrower until all you see ahead of you is Jesus. You're not worried about the right, and you're not worried about the left. Hallelujah. They're preaching everything under the sun now inside of Jesus Christ. Inside the church, I should say. It's inside their congregation. But inside the church, the body of Christ is complete victory. And that's where you want to get. When you are baptized into the Spirit, behold, all things are become new. Let me tell you, everything changes. What was up is now down. What was down is now up. What was left is right. I mean, at first you're really confused. You're thinking, wow, everything just changed. Yeah, you're in the spirit now. You're in the spirit, man. But you know what? This guy's going to try to resurrect. He's going to try to come up and be in charge and large. And you can't follow him no more. As you walk through this life, as you learn the word of God, as you learn about the Master, Jesus Christ, hallelujah. You know, we call him Lord and King and all these other names. That means we're his subjects. If we're in his kingdom and he's a king, that means I'm his subject. And I am subject to what he tells me to do. Like I said earlier, the Lord said, why call me Lord? Do not the things what I say. It's not going to work. That plan of attack will not work with God. God does not deal with hypocrisy. Thank you, Jesus. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord. That means judged. That means guilty. When we mess up, we're chastened of the Lord. That we should not be condemned with the world. You see there how all that works? First, if we would keep an eye on ourselves, God don't have to. But when we mess up, he rebukes us. He chastens us. He lets us know you're wrong. We repent with godly sorrow. We're forgiven. Hallelujah. That we should not be condemned with what? The world, sinners. The world are the people that are still in this sinful flesh body. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going back to Matthew 7. I told you, the road is getting narrower all the time. And how am I going to help my brother and sister in the Lord? He said, you know, how am I going to pull out a mote out of my little teeny sliver, out of my brother's eye, out of my sister's eye, when I got a beam in my own eye? And I can't see if it's light or day out. And I got all these prejudices, all these different bigotries, and I feel either entitled, disenfranchised. Entitled, that means you think everyone and everything in this world owes you something. Disenfranchised means that you don't think that you're worthy of this glorious gospel. You're not worthy of this life to come. Both worldviews are wrong. Hallelujah. I'm glad to say it's not about us. Number one, it's about Jesus. And yes, you know what? If we accept what he has done by faith, we are worthy of this glorious gospel. But there is a work to be done now. And that is in my heart. Thank you, Jesus. Let's go to Matthew 7 and 13 and 14. Enter ye in at the straight gate. Enter you in at the straight gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate and broad is the way that leads unto life, and few there be that find it. So we come to a point where, you know what? I said it. The road will get narrower. And you got to allow God to keep pulling you along. He said, follow me. Follow me. Don't worry about what the world's doing. The left, the right. Everyone's doing their thing. Everyone thinks they're right. Everyone, now they got this political correctness. And they're saying all sorts of things are right now. You know what? If it ain't in the Bible, and if God didn't tell me it, I know it's not right. Hallelujah. And I'm not going to move away from God's promises of eternal life inside me. I know it's wrong. As you grow older in the faith, as you mature in the faith, you have spiritual discernment. And you know when flesh is speaking, and you know when the spirit is speaking. And thank you, Jesus. We can have the victory. And if we start to stray off, God will nudge us back to the center. He'll nudge us back. Yes, he will. Thank you, Jesus. He'll nudge us back. Let's go to Luke 21. Luke 21 and 33. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Thank you, Jesus. And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and the cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares. Surfeiting means to be overindulgent. So you're overcharged, you're doing this and you're doing that, you're doing all these things, and you think you got it going on. You got to take heed that the old man doesn't resurrect. That's exactly what it says, and that's exactly what it means. They say you can't backslide. Well, I'm looking here. It says, take heed that you do it not. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. That means, you know what? It's a snare. It's a trick. It's a lie of the enemy. He's got a little bait out there. Come on. You know this is good. You know you want this. And I don't care what it is. He'll go back and look in your past. Yes, he will. And find something that he knows that this flesh man used to like. Just like the Egyptians fed the Israelites all these things. And they actually wanted to go back into that hard bondage. The world will give you things that your old man likes. Or used to like anyway. And they'll tempt you with these things. But don't be tempted with the things of this world. Thank you, Jesus. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. That means we are not exempt from the temptations. Watch ye therefore and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. So we gotta know what we're going through, how we're going to succeed to go through. I hear a lot of people teaching about things that, you know what, it doesn't really concern me, about how it's going to be in the last days and all these things. And they're so sure that they're right about these. You know what? You get right with God. You just sell out to Jesus. And all those things can happen till their heart's desire. I don't care. I'm not going to be subject to them. I'm subject to my Heavenly Father personally. And when all these things come upon me, as are written in Revelation, and all these prophecies back in Daniel and Revelation, all these end time ministry things, you know what? I'm not going to worry about them, because I'm going to be right with God, and he's going to deliver me from them. It says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord will deliver him out of them all. So I got my deliverance when I am in him and he's in me. Thank you, Jesus. That's a spiritual baptism. God showed it to me in a vision. My heart is already risen in the glory. And he's doing that radical makeover in my inner man's spirit, the heart of my inner man. The spirit and the heart are the same thing in the Bible. Not the one that pumps blood, but my heavenly heart, which is my spirit, and my soul now is being clothed by his spirit, which is his radiant glory. He's clothing my soul, which was once naked. He's clothing it in his radiant glory. Hallelujah. So I'm in him, and he's in me. We are one in the spirit. And the devil's not going to cut in on that dance, not as long as I don't let go. I let go. God can't force me to go. But through this life, I'm learning that, you know what? If I don't let go of Jesus, he won't let go of me. And I glory to God. That's what I preach. That's the way I preach. And Luke 21 and 19 says, in your patience, possess ye your soul. So our patience. Sometimes God expands our patience. Right now, he's making me be real patient. Hallelujah. He's stringing things out. He's moving things backward and back. And he's telling me, just keep coming. And he's telling me, read your Bible. Read your Bible. Just keep pressing. And he's strengthening my heart. Hallelujah. So I won't be moved by every wind of doctrine. Let me turn there. I like this. I haven't used this on this show in a long time. Matthew 13 and 19. Matthew 13 and 19. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and understands it not, then comes the wicked one and catches away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. I know our understanding is simply doing what it says. My understanding, whenever you see the word understanding, it means you got to live this life. My understanding is flat out reading it like it is, living it like it is, and I'm going to get where he is. Where? Right here and right now. I have a personal relationship, and I'm not worried what the world says. So these so-called prophets and these doctors of this denomination and these theologians and all these other people, they're going to come up to me and try to convince that there's an error in my doctrine. And I'm looking at it thinking, I know that it works. I know exactly what God told me. And if I'm wrong, God will lead me. Hallelujah, because I have his Holy Spirit. He'll say, no, they're right. And you know what? I'll repent in a second and say, you're right. Thank you. Like I said before, we have, as you get older in the faith, you have spiritual discernment. And you know when the Spirit is talking. And you know when flesh is talking. Hallelujah. There's only two spirits that are going to lead you. One is God's and one is the devil. You're going to be led by one or the other. And we want to be led by the Spirit of the living God. And the only way you can be led by him is faith in Jesus Christ. That is through the cross. And now that he's risen, he's at the right hand of the throne of the majesty on high, and he wants to fill us with the Spirit. So he's now Christ Jesus. So when you see Christ before Jesus, that simply means the Holy Spirit dispensation. Let me go back here. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and understands it not, then comes the wicked one and catches away that which was sown in his heart. This is he that receives seed by the wayside. So when our understanding, our resolve, I know this word works. Certain scriptures have such power with me because it's been worked out in my life. And I know as long as I got my finger on it and I can read it, this is exactly what it means. I know by experience that I can back that devil off. Hallelujah. When I live for my Heavenly Father, and he will back that devil off. I can't back him off other than the fact that I'm doing what he tells me to do. And that very act of being obedient to my Heavenly Father will do it for me. Hallelujah. He cannot put his hand upon the anointed of God. God said in his prophecy, touch not my anointed. He was talking to that devil. Touch not my anointed. He gave that devil a commandment. And let me tell you something. That devil will obey. Oh, yes, he will. When God has his word on it, the only way the devil can trip us up is having us disobey what God said in his word. So when you don't know what his word is, how are you going to obey? So we read this stuff. This is my life. This needs to be your life. This, you got to get in here. You can't just read these things like they're little Bible stories. This is spirit and truth. Jesus said in St. John 6 and 63, it is the spirit that quickens. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Spirit and life. Thank you, Jesus. So when I got my finger on it, I know exactly what he's talking about here. What do I mean by in the flesh? I can't jump high enough. We were singing a song. I went and preached at another church today. And we were singing a song. I like the song. I'm not going to criticize the song. It was a good song. But you know what? You could take it fleshly. I will clap my hands. I will jump. I will sing praises. I'm going to do this. And I love you, Lord. And I will do this. And I will do that. You know what? If you love God, simply keep his commandments. Do what he told you to do. And you will have life forevermore. You do what he says in these pages, and you will have life. And the nice thing about the new covenant is he's given us of his spirit to give us his grace, which is his sufficiency, that show us right from wrong. Thank you, Jesus. Watch as well as pray. Who am I going to watch? Everyone, especially me. I'm going to keep an eye on me. That's that if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. That's that scripture I just read to you back there, 1 Corinthians 11, 31 and 32. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to Luke 17 now. Watch as well as pray. We got to watch. We got to keep an eye. Hallelujah. Number one on us. I got to keep an eye on me. That's a full-time job. Thank you, Jesus. I can be at home by myself thinking a thought that I'm not supposed to think. And the Spirit will come to me and say, what are you thinking about? And I'm like, oh, boy. You're right. You know, I'm thinking something that I ought not to be thinking on. Thank you, Jesus. But he is there. And all I have to do is say, Lord, I'm sorry. And then move on. Thank you, Jesus. You can be on in a cave on a deserted island. You know what? Your salvation is not a guaranteed, even there, that the flesh won't resurrect. But when you got the Holy Spirit, he will lead you and guide you. Luke 17, 20 and 21. And when he was demanded of the Pharisees, when the kingdom of God should come, they all thought it was going to be on earth. They all thought when the Messiah came, the kingdom would come down on earth. And they're still preaching the same thing today. The kingdom's going to come on earth, and we're all going to live in this place. You know what? I don't even care. If I get right with God, I don't care what the kingdom is going to look like. Here's why. Listen to this. Listen to this. Let this sink into your heart. And when he was demanded, not questioned, but demanded, they said, tell us now, mister. And they're pointing their finger with judgment into Emmanuel, God with us. Holy cow. How would you like to be these guys, the Pharisees? When the kingdom of God should come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God comes not with observation. You can't see it. Neither shall they say, lo here or lo there. For behold, the kingdom of God is within you. That is joy in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. Thank you, Jesus. Which is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Romans 14 and 17. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink. You can also say flesh and blood there. You know, it says in another place, flesh and blood shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So get that down. Don't worry about something to come on this world. You know what? Whatever God does later on, that's fine. If I'm right with him right now, I'm good to go. Like I tell you, I'm already risen. My heart is already in the glory. You see me, but this man's crucified. I am dead to this world. Paul said, I'm going to turn there. right now. Paul said in Galatians 6, 14 and 15, but God forbid that I should glory of his accomplishments, of anything that he's done. You know, that's why, you know, when I am weak, then am I strong in him, because I'm turning loose my ambitions of doing. I've gotten ahead of God many a times in my life, thinking I was doing God's service, and I was actually in the way. I've done it. Me, right here. Not somebody else. I'll point the finger at me. But God had mercy on me. Thank you, Jesus. But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. I'm no longer moved by this world. Thank you, Jesus. That's what that means. It no longer moves me. It no longer thrills me. I can't go to Disney World and feel that I've accomplished something great. You know, I'm not going to have a bucket list in my life, but I'm going to do what my Heavenly Father says, and my heart is going to be enriched in his love and his kindness and his gentleness. For in Christ Jesus, you see, the Christ before Jesus means the Holy Spirit dispensation. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision avails anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. There you go, that new creature, that new creation, that heavenly body. My soul man is now going to be clothed in his radiant glory. When I lay this man down, I'm going to go up and I'm going to meet the Lord in the air. Hallelujah. And that's scripture. And I'm going to hold God to it. He says he's going to do it. I'm saying, you know what, Lord? As long as I'm doing everything that your word tells me to do, I know you are faithful and just. It says in, I believe it is Job, God will not cast away a perfect man. God will not cast away a perfect man. In James 3 and 2 says, that man has learned to bridle his tongue. And when he's bridled his tongue, he can bridle the whole body. He can make this man mine, my inner man. Hallelujah. My inner man, soul and heart, tells this guy what he can do and what he should do. Hallelujah. And now he minds me. Whereas when I was in sin, I minded him. Oh, yeah. Sin in the flesh is like either a hook in the jaw or a ring in the nose. And the devil's just going to reach up there and lead you about on your tippy toes, making you look like a fool. Sin will make a plumb fool out of you. But you don't have to stay there. That's what I'm preaching. You don't have to stay that sinful man no longer. Glory to God. You can come out of that mess. And God says, I am your sufficiency, my grace. That is his holy word, made flesh and dwelt among us, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Boy, I went through a bunch there just now. Let's go to 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy. I want to touch on this real quick, because we get educated and we suddenly think we're somebody. And the Bible says, Paul said that, don't think you're somebody when you're nothing, because we're nothing without Jesus. That's number one. Without Jesus, I can do nothing. Hallelujah. Without his guidance, without his spirit, without a sacrifice on the cross, with everything this book preaches that he had done for me, without him, I can do nothing. So my intellect, I can't run fast enough, I can't sing good enough, I can't be smart enough, all these different fleshly attributes, there's nothing I can do to please God but live this life. Hallelujah. Let's go to 1 Timothy 3. This is a true saying. If a man desire the office of a bishop, he desires a good work. Okay, fair enough, bishop. But it's a title given by man. It's a title. You know, some people have doctor's degrees. Trust me, it means nothing to God. A bishop must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine nor striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous, one that rules well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. With all gravity. For if a man knows not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Not a novice. Least being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. So we see here, here's some guidelines. And they're more than guidelines. When it's the word of God, God called them commandments. When you do these things, you shall not fall, as it says. And you can't be a novice. That means you had to walk around the block a couple times. You had to experience this stuff. You had to go to a point. You had to grow to a point. You had to grow to a point, not go to a point. It's not like you can go to this point and all is going to be. You got to grow in. It says grow in grace. There's one place that says grow in God's grace. So we're growing in God's grace, and we come to a point where we realize, you know what, this works, and what man is telling me does not work. I know what man is telling me is not working, because the world, in my humble opinion, is still on its way to hell. And they're lost, and they're flaying their arms around, and their legs, and they're making a big fuss, and they're all, you know, debating each other. We don't debate. We read the Word of God, and as the Holy Spirit interprets, I reveal the revelation that He gave me. And thank you, Jesus. He's given me plenty to get me all the way to glory. And I'm going to give that to you. So instead of me worrying about what's going to come on down the road, I'm going to teach people how to get saved and stay that way. Hallelujah. And I'm not going to preach anything other than the straight, narrow path. And that way will lead you to the goodness of God shed abroad in your heart. I wouldn't have lasted. If God would have left me like I was when I was in the world, I would not have made it this far. But thank you, Jesus, He did not leave me that way. He brought me out one thing at a time. I say it a lot. When He comes and He'll start pulling those old things out, those character flaws, those sinful traits, those things that mankind themselves don't like about me. Hallelujah. He pulls those out one at a time. And then somewhere down the road, you look back and you see where you used to be and you think, my God, was I really that bad? That was you. I can remember even back then thinking, this is not who I am. Why am I acting this way? This is not who I am. But there I was saying all those things, telling all those stale jokes, you know, like a rooster walking around in the farmyard, you know, strutting my stuff, thinking I was some kind of fella, when I was totally miserable, lost, and on my way to hell. And I couldn't change that man. You couldn't have brought psychology to me and changed me. This was an inside job of the heart only God could do. And by His grace, He got it done. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So we see here, titles ain't going to do you a bit of good. You know, there's a lot of preachers, I'm telling you, on their way to hell, preaching a lost, hopeless doctrine, and living like a twofold child of the devil, thinking they got it going on. They will be judged. And fortunately, God's children will be judged in this present world. And He's going to chasten us, and He's going to rebuke us. My name of the subject is watch as well as pray. We got to keep an eye on ourselves, and we got to keep an eye on that devil. When he tries to rear up his ugly head, you can say, you got the power, as a child of God, you got the power to say, in the name of Jesus, you die now. And I'm talking about this flesh. I'm talking about other people that come against me. I'm not gonna insult them and tell, you know, like Peter. Peter was rebuked by Jesus. He said, get behind me, Satan. It is, you know, you get behind me. He wasn't talking to Peter personally. He was talking to that spirit that was guiding Peter. That's a pretty strong rebuke, I might add. Where was I going to turn to? God, Ephesians 6. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Ephesians 6. I'm going to start at 11. Watch as well as pray. Put on the whole armor of God. You can't go into battle. And we're going against a worthy adversary. God called the devil a worthy adversary. He is a worthy adversary. He even tried to trip up Jesus with the scriptures in the temptation in the wilderness. Yeah, he even tried to get Jesus to worship him. And you know what? You can't worship God and mammon at the same time. You're going to hate the one and love the other. So I suggest you love God and forget about the things of this world. And you need to be crucified to the things of this world, just like Paul, just like I am. Hallelujah. I'm being crucified day by day in this present life. Hallelujah. And God said, I can get it done. Now, I can either believe what he says, or I can believe what the devil says. And the devil will try to convince you, oh, you know he can't get it done. You're only flesh. God knows your own. No. My flesh is crucified with Christ. My sinful flesh is crucified, and I am a temple of the Holy Ghost. Put on the whole armor of God. You can't send a ragtag group of soldiers that have no training, no nothing. You've got to have that entire armor on. Hallelujah. That ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. He's a crafty one. He knows this word as good as anyone, but he can't live it. That's his problem. He knows the word, but he cannot live it. There is a distinction there. For we which wrestle, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So flesh and blood, our fellow man, is not our enemy. Get that down. What that means is we wrestle not against flesh and blood. We're not wrestling against those that are coming against us. We're wrestling against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Thank you, Jesus. That's what we're wrestling against. Just like Peter was rebuked by Jesus and told, you're not doing what my heavenly Father wants you to do. He was letting them know and letting us know because it's in his word now. Therefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. Don't go into battle without the whole armor. And now I'm going to show you what it is. That ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, get this, stand therefore. That means on your own two feet, you're going to stand up upright in this world, and you're going to proclaim the goodness of God to a lost and dying world, and you don't care what they take. They're not all going to receive it, and they're going to wound you, and you're going to walk around, I'm a Christian, don't hate me. No. There's no power in that moping spirit. I hear way too many so-called Christian songs crying out, oh, Lord, how long? You know what? It's a battle. You're in a battle. Stop asking how long and just go with it. And you're going to find out that he loves you the whole time. But we are indeed in a battle. We are indeed in a battle. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore. Just like our worldly parents, when we were toddlers, we were taking them first steps, and they got their arm. That's just like how God is with us. He's saying, stand now. Stand. You know, we're not supposed to always be on our belly crying and moping. Having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, my righteousness ain't of me, it's of God. He's given it to me. Hallelujah. That your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. You'll see the fiery darts of the wicked in Isaiah 54 and 17, and that is a lying tongue. And God said, and their righteousness is of me. He's speaking prophecy yonder. Hallelujah. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Thank you, Jesus. Our only offensive weapon isn't me speaking my fleshly mind at somebody. The word of God is our only offensive weapon. Everything else here is defensive. Our offensive weapon is the word of God. And when you speak the word of God, you will, by your heavenly nature, back that devil off. And you can command him in the name of Jesus. And you know what? He'll have to back off. I mean, he might hide around the corner and lob little things at you here and there. But you know what? You'll get to a point. You'll realize, I got this saying I've heard many times. I use it all the time. I love this saying. I don't know who said it originally. Or I'd attribute to them. But when we were 20, we were worried with what the world thought about us. But by the time we became 50, we realized that the world wasn't thinking about us at all. They don't care if you get saved. The world, it really doesn't. It really doesn't. They probably won't even come to your funeral unless they know that there's apple salad there or some kind of dessert that they like. That's the world. They go someplace, they expect to receive something. But a child of God, they go someplace because they have compassion for that person. Hallelujah. And they're reaching for that soul. And when we were 20, we were offended because we were all in these sinful bodies. And we didn't know if it was night or day out. And we were just doing what it told me to do. Now I'm telling it how to behave itself. And the Spirit of God inside me is enabling me to get this glorious new birth accomplished. Hallelujah. I know I couldn't have done it through the law of Moses. You know, don't do this, don't do that, don't go here, don't. I couldn't have done it because I was trying to do it without my own power. But now my power is guaranteed from my Heavenly Father. When He tells me to do something and I do it, I got victory in that thing He told me to do. And I can accomplish those things that He tells me to do. That's the faith part. Faith isn't me going out doing my own thing and telling God to bless it. That's not faith. Faith is God telling me what to do, and I behave Him, including His word. And that is the faith that He's talking about. I'm not going to go command God to bless my mess and expect Him to get it done. Hallelujah. He knows what I have need of. And He'll tell me when I need something and when I don't need something. And I'm like, glory to God. He told me, I will never have need for nothing. If I need it, I will bring it to you. Don't go look for it. Thank you, Jesus. And I'm out of time. My closing, as always, from Psalm 19, 12 through 14. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Now may the good Lord richly bless all your sincere efforts, that you might lead a quiet and peaceful life and go out there and with full assurance and with full purpose of heart, knowing what you're doing is pleasing your Heavenly Father. There is peace in that life. There is joy in that life. And you're not ashamed because you know He done that glorious work in your heart, and He's able to do it for others as well. He is able. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.